There is a river where goodness flows. There is a fountain that drowns sorrows. There is an ocean deeper than fear. The tide is rising, rising. There is a current stirring deep inside. It's overflowing from the heart. Yeah. your name is power. Breath and living water. Such a marvelous mystery. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is and is to come. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings.
Holy Spirit.
More than words can say, I need you more.
more than the song I sing, more than anything, I need you, Lord. More than the air I breathe, more than the song I sing, more than anything, I need you, Lord. More than the air I breathe, more than the song I sing, more than anything, I need you, Lord. I need you more than yesterday. I need you more. Yes, we do. So much more than words can say. I need you.
Let's all lift our hands.
Just tell him, Lord, I still need you more than anything else. I don't need anything like I need you. Lord, I don't need anything else. All I need is Jesus. You know how I know that? Because I have to live with me every day. You ever live with you too? Aren't you glad Jesus shed his blood for us? Now, while you're standing there, I want you to listen to this. Forget about what you've been thinking about. Forget about what you've been thinking about. You're not going to come into the presence of God with a sin consciousness. You have to forget all that. Say, everybody say, the blood has been shed for all that. I'm moving forward. Say that. Therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom we also have access by faith into this grace wherein we stand, and rejoice in hope of the glory of God. And not only so, but we glory in tribulations, knowing that tribulation works patience in us. Patience works experience. Experience works hope. And hope makes not ashamed, because the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost, which is given to us. Another gift. For when we were yet without strength, in due time, Christ died for the ungodly. Say, I qualified.
I qualified.
For scarcely for a righteous man will one die. Yet, peradventure, for a good man, some would even dare to die. But God commends his love toward us, in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Much more than being now justified by his blood, we shall be saved from wrath through him. For if, when we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his son, much more being reconciled, we'll be saved by his life. And not only so, we also joy in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom we have now received the atonement. Wherefore, as by one man sin entered into the world, talking about Adam, and death entered in by sin, so death passed upon all men, all of us, for all have sinned. For until the law, sin was in the world, but sin is not imputed where there's no law. Nevertheless, death reigned from Adam all the way to Moses, even over them that had not sinned after the similitude of Adam's transgression, who was the figure of him that was to come. But not as the offense, so also is the free gift. For if through the offense of one many be dead, much more the grace of God and the gift by grace, which is by one man, Jesus Christ, has abounded to many. And not as it was by one that sinned, so is the gift. For the judgment was by one to condemnation, but the free gift is of many offenses unto justification. For if by one man's offense death reigned by one, much more they which receive abundance of grace and of the gift of righteousness shall reign in life by one, Jesus Christ. Therefore, As by the offense of one, judgment came upon all men to condemnation, even so by the righteousness of one, the free gift came upon all men unto justification of life. He's going to say it to you another way. For as by one man's disobedience many were made sinners, even so by the obedience of one shall many be made righteous. So whose obedience was necessary to make you righteous? Yours? His. Moreover, the law entered that the offense might abound. But where sin abounded, grace did much more abound. That as sin has reigned unto death, even so might grace reign through righteousness unto eternal life by Jesus Christ our Lord. That always be the gospel. Enough for us this morning. Hallelujah. Now look. Look at the one next to you and say, now quit condemning me. I'm going to quit condemning myself. Hug somebody and say, Jesus' blood was even good enough for you.
Thank you.
Daddy Bunch this morning, aren't they? Don't you love it? I love the life. I love the life this morning. I have been fortunate. Just a little bit until they start covering up, and then you can back it off. Mr. Fantagrossi, if you'll approach the platform with me, please, sir. Him up just a little bit. Do that thing with this microphone that you normally do. Call me angry sea. He alone decides who writes a symphony.
He lights every star that makes the darkness bright. He keeps watch all through each long and lonely night.
He still finds the time to hear a child's first prayer. Saint or sinner call, they'll always find him there. The Lord made him sad to see the way men live. He'll always say, I forgive. He can grant a wish
or make a dream come true.
He can touch a cloud
and turn the gray blue.
He alone knows where to find a rainbow's end.
He
alone can see
what lies around the bend.
He can touch a tree and turn the leaves to gold.
He knows every lie that you and I have told.
Lord made him sad to see the way men live. Jesus came to forgive. I had to bring that Italian in on me. There is a lot of things we need to do this morning, but one is most important. We've got announcements. I want you to know that we're going to receive an offering and let the kids go to Children's Church and all that stuff. And I know it's store day for the kids. Yay! And I'm going back and forth about whether or not the kids should stay here and listen, because the greatest missionary evangelist that I have ever heard tell of or known on the face of the earth is right here with us. Kevin and Leslie McNulty are here this morning, and I think y'all just shout hallelujah. You have no idea who's here. Here we are working for 15, 20 years here, 23 years now, and we're trying to reach our county. See the world map? They have full expression in 60 countries or better. My God. And you know, every time I'm around Kevin McNulty, the Holy Ghost chatters at me and jabbers and talks. And just when I'm around him, I want to go next to him just so I can hear from God. So what did, where's Judy? What did I say to you this morning about the numbers of what we're supposed to be reaching? Do you remember when I was talking about church? I said we needed to grow and we needed to reach a certain number. Do you remember the number? Did you hear what she said? Hear what she said? I said that to her this morning. I said, I can tell there's a 500 member church in me, and my facility is, we're here, we're taking good care of the facility. We're here every Sunday morning. We're here Sunday night in the school, Monday night in the school. We teach Wednesday night. We have a Sunday school class. We have children's church here. We have a dance team. We go on and on. We have a Thursday night practice with the worship team. And then we use the building for other things. And then today, Kevin McNulty said, he walked in and said,
well, I looked around and I heard 500 should be here.
And so I said, I stood here during worship. I said, Lord, I said, I just know. Listen, for me, he knows. It's not been about numbers to me. For me, it's been about one person that's distressed. One. That's me, isn't it? If one is distressed, that's the only person I see. That's the only one that's on my mind. That's the difference in the pastor. See, he's got to go after countries. He's got a net, big one. I got a fishing pole. I hook one in, I look right at it, real close, look right at it. See, it's the difference in ministries. I said, now, Lord, it's not about numbers. I know that. But I know you want to do something. I'd try to sell this. My mind is sell this building, sell it, and sell it for a fair deal to the next pastor that comes in. We did all the work here to get this thing together. The next pastor just needs me to give him my key. He turns the doorknob. That's the hardest it'll get for him, because this place is ready. And he just let me know. He says, son, just go find the building you're looking for. I'll show you if you have to board this up. We'll do something else with this. I've had this here 100 years. So now stretch your hands out here toward me. See, I hear from God in a way that I don't hear from him when I'm not in Kevin's presence. There's an anointing on him that does something to me. Just pray the Lord gives me wisdom, and not emotion. Not emotion, just wisdom as to what to do. In Jesus' name. Yes, ma'am, please.
When I woke up this morning, I heard this, and I was praying for you all, and I heard the Lord say, faithful. And then he said it again today in the service. And so two scriptures came to me, but the Lord is faithful, and he will strengthen you, and he will guard you from the evil one. And we are confident in the Lord that you are doing and will continue to do the things. Now, it says we commanded, but I would say he commanded you. May the Lord lead your hearts into a full understanding and expression of the love of God and the patient endurance that comes from Christ. And there's one other place. And this was real strong, this scripture. For faithful is he that calleth you, who will also do it. Yes. Do it.
Oh, my goodness. He's doing it. He'll do it.
That was so important. I woke up this morning and I said, okay, here we are, Lord. Here we are. And I heard him say, faithful are my servants. And I walked over to the window. I don't know if you do that when you pray. I walked over to the window in the hotel room, and I looked out across the green, and I heard him just say, faithful. They've been so faithful. In the thick and in the thin, in the hard and in the easy, in the ups and in the downs, and in all the all arounds. Faithful. And faithful is he who has called you, and he will do it.
Okay. Hear the word of the Lord. Hear the word of the Lord. All right. Well, as you know, homecoming is coming on. And what is our goal?
200 people.
And what is our soul goal? We're going to have 12 new births on May the 7th. See the whiteboard over there? We have these commitment cards that you signed last week. We're going to start pinning them to the board. All right, let me have my ushers run up right quick. If you didn't get a card that says, Dear Pastor John, I commit to be at Church on the Word Sunday, May 7th for homecoming. Sign a contract with me and promise to be here. Only if you didn't sign one. Only if you did not sign one, get a card. One for each family member, even for your children. It's not one per family. It's one per person. We're going to post it on the board so that we'll see, keep a track, a general track, pretty specific track of the number of people we'll have here. Where are we going to put 200 people, Pastor John? Oh, don't worry about that. The Lord will figure it out. If we put 130 in here, we'd have room for 60 downstairs. They're looking at the platform, all the unused space. We could pack a choir. We could. Just turn on the air conditioner on Monday before we... See, they're speaking evangelistically. And rightly so. All right, this is a 7-week campaign. We've got 6 weeks to go before the big day event. So each week, we have things that have to be done. Now, with each week, on Sunday, immediately after the service, I'm going to hold a quick 15-minute meeting with all the department heads, the coordinators, and those of you that don't have one thing to do. You have to find one. Everybody, this is a hospital ship, and it's every man, every hand on deck. Every hand to do something. There's something that everyone can do, and everybody can put their hands to the good work, because when the 12 get born again, then if all the Lord said for you to do is write a letter or to make some phone calls or to just help Pastor John with the campaign in some simple way, those 12 souls are added to your account. That's the way that works. This is a campaign. And while my first responsibility is to feed the flock of God, which is given to me, taking the oversight thereof, that's my first job, and to watch for their souls, that's job number one for a pastor. He also told Timothy, the young pastor, he said, to do the work of an evangelist. And that's what we're going to do, reach out to the local community, and we reach out through the people. We'll provide the place. The Holy Ghost will provide his presence. and the Spirit of God will draw. Now, those of you that have not, no one's done this yet. There's another card here. It's a different color. There's a green one and a yellow one. This one here says, "Dear Pastor John, I commit to bring one visitor to Church on the Word May 7th for homecoming." Come here, ushers. Run these out to the people. Everybody gets one. "I commit to bring one person, one visitor to Church on the Word for homecoming." Sign it. Don't look for church people. There's plenty. Listen, 9% of Douglas County went to church last Sunday morning. 9% of 145,000 people. Do the math. There's over, well over 100,000 people that not only they don't, I would dare say that I have 120,000 that didn't go to church or so last week here in our county. There's 50,000 of them that don't even know a church, a pastor, don't even know anybody who goes. Plenty of room to bring people to church. Yeah, I believe we can be 500 because I believe you can help me handle 500. I know you can. Yes. There's a lot of folks that need Jesus. Yeah. I talked to Tom and Kathy Walker this week. They're excited about flying in. He's going to play his guitar. I brought you here to preach. Go ahead.
I'm an evangelist, all right? And I'll tell you something. People come for food. And then before they get to the food, they pass right through here. And if there's only less than 9% of your county is turning out on a Sunday morning, they'll love to come for church on the lawn, food on the lawn, or however you're going to do. Maybe you're doing it in here or in a tent or something outside.
Free meal for their family. They don't have to cook. It could be big.
So folks, don't be nervous. Listen, do not be nervous. People turn out. Invite them to come. They will come. Because it's a family, and I tell you what, we haven't been here in a lot of years, and I walk through that door, and I can tell you're a family. You're just chatting and talking and hugging and loving and communicating, and they need that. They hurt. They want that. They want that. And if you just wrap your arms around them and invite them and get them involved, they'll come. They'll come, Pastor. Oh.
Confirmation.
They'll come. They will come. Listen. I'm sorry. Let's see. 2 years ago, I was sitting in a conference, and someone began to share their testimony of how... Actually, I'll tell you, it was Dennis Burke. He shared his testimony about the wild hippie boy that he was. And the Lord spoke to me as he was sharing his testimony, and he said, "If we don't get ready, we're going to miss the harvest, because the harvest is wide open again in America." He said, "They're not going to look like we think they should look. They're not going to act like we think they should act," because Dennis Burke wasn't looking and acting like we thought he probably needed to look and act in my Baptist church where I grew up. And honestly, if we're not careful, in our word churches, we can be just the same as those good old Baptists. Isn't that true? It's time. But he said, "Get ready. Another Jesus movement is coming to America." Now listen, I just picked up something and I've got to get connected with them via the Christian news airwaves. And the Lord spoke to us to get tents ready for America. And I just heard that this fall on the mall, they're putting up a tent from all of the 50 United States, and they're putting up regional tents. And this group, which has been a prayer group previously, has a desire to mobilize young people with tents to preach the gospel across America. In America. And they're starting in the mall in D.C. And we've been planning, and we've got evangelists. Listen.
We've got two evangelists from other countries coming here, and now they're here and they're living here with us.
God's given them green cards, which means legal residency. And they are some of our key evangelists. Now, we're not done. We're still working over there. They've got big teams overseas. But we're strategizing and planning for America. So I just want you to know that one person that says to you, I'm not interested, just keep on cruising, because there's 10 more that are interested.
Yes, that's the word. That's the emphasis.
Just keep on doing it. Get ready. It's a Jesus movement. Hey, if you're under the age of 30... You can be under any age. Listen, you could be a retiree. One of our former board members said to me, he said, there'd be no place better than to preach in all these campgrounds across America. He said, bring a little tent. He said, we set up our RVs and we have a Bible study. Folks, it's wide open. How to invite somebody. Well, how would I invite somebody? It just depends. I would say, hey, we're having a celebration, and I want you to come and join in and be a part. And I want you to know we're going to have some good cooking. We're going to have probably some music. We're going to have some fellowship. And I want you to see, you know, and experience what I do. And listen, the best testimony you can ever give is your own. People say, I went to a small church in Central Florida, in Daytona. They invited us to come over to preach, and I love the pastor and his family. He gave me 15 points of what you need to know before you can preach the gospel. And I sat there because I just showed up. I had a prophetic word for the church, and I just was cruising through town, and I thought I had to go on the way to a plane, you know, to go by his church. And I gave him the prophetic word. And then I sat down to catch the rest of his message, and I was like, whoa, I don't know those 15 things. I said, Lord, do I qualify to evangelize somebody? I can't even remember the 15 things this pastor just said. Do you understand? Remember the fresh feeling of a new convert. There's nothing like the fresh feeling of a new convert. Nothing like it. Oh, I don't remember. I mean, I always went to church. I always understood. Well, then read somebody else's book. And get their fresh feeling of being a new convert. I remember what it was like without Jesus. I grew up in the church. And then I walked away thinking my way would be better. It only took me about 6 months to figure out I needed to run home. But I had been an athlete. Guess what sport I played? Basketball. I had been a college athlete, a top student. And everything had always come easily for me. And I walked away from God. And it didn't take but just a couple of months that I failed a class for the first time in my life. And I laid down in basketball practice and I could not get up. I could not walk. My back was so bad. And it just got worse that whole year. And I had one college roommate who was manic, depressive, suicidal. And the other one who was calling home and getting drug money from their parents and lying about school fees. And they painted a psychedelic rainbow around the room and played AC/DC 24/7. I had been transported to hell on earth. You understand? And when that semester ended and I ran home, and I walked into my bedroom in my parents' house, and there was a little Days Inn Bible my dad had picked up from all his travels, a Days Inn Bible, and it had that bright glowing sun on the front. And I fell over my bed, and my hand fell on that Bible, and I opened it up, and it fell to "In the beginning." And God so, and I just kept reading, and God so loved the world. And do you know, a great white light in my mind filled that room, and I was instantly healed. And I've never been the same. I remember that fresh feeling. Yours might not be that dramatic. It might be the day God answered a prayer for you. It might be the day that you saw that you avoided an accident, or you knew, you said, my child's not going to go there today, and something happened and you avoided something. Who knows what that experience is in your life? Or they were going to claim bankruptcy on you and God gave you a way out. Whatever it might be. Your testimony is the best message they can ever hear. Amen. Remember the fresh feeling of being a new convert. of him washing you and touching you and cleansing you and cleaning you. There's nothing like it. Amen. All right, Pastor.
Y'all need to give that girl a hand. You see why they're in multiple countries? The spirit of the exhorter. Let's receive this morning's tithes and offerings, shall we? Gentlemen, come forward. Let me have both prayer cards and the cash envelopes. If you're giving in cash, raise your hand. These gentlemen will wait on you. Wow. Thank you, Leslie. Thank you, dear.
How to do it?
Mm-hmm, I do. So tell them to put their cards on. Yeah, just a minute. We have those cards there. You just hold on to those. Give you a minute, get your offering prepared. Notice this fine printed card that we have up here that says, you are invited to homecoming at Church on the Word. And it says, bring the whole family and stay for our complimentary lunch immediately after service. Now, what they don't know is we're going to be having a drawing for kids' prizes. I'm even going to auction off. Just to the guy, not an auction, just to the guy that happened to have the right ticket. A nice flat screen TV. And you can tell him, hey, look, we're going to have a drawing for a flat screen TV. If you'll come in and get a number, you might win it. That'll help you. You want to come back up from Daytona? All right, so ushers, run back up here right quick before we receive our offering. Two to three per family. Oh, yeah, they're slippery. They want to get out. See, they don't want to be here. Right. It's not to remind you. I'm going to remind you every week. In fact, everybody in here is going to receive a phone call, including the pastor, to remind you of homecoming. These are for you to hold on to and take to other people. In just a minute, we're going to receive the offerings, and I want you to drop your commitment card in the offering bucket with your offering. Both commitment cards, the one that says, Pastor John, I will be at Church on the Word, and the one that says, Pastor John, I will bring one visitor. I know it. The last time we had anything like this was in 2014, so it's been 3 years. Do you know who? You know who brought the most people that week? We thought it was Darlene. She brought 10. Hank brought 11. Lord, thank you for letting me know Hank. Thank you, sir. Tell that brother I love him. Come on, love it. There was a kid that came that Sunday that answered the altar call. His name was James Dean Stevens. Everybody called him James Dean. He'd had a lot of troubles in his life. He'd been to churches and seen religion. But man, when he got saved that Sunday, he said, man, when it's real, you know it's real. He just kept talking about Jesus really was real. He's real. I found out Jesus today is real, man. It's not just some story in a Sunday school class. He just went on and on and on. Since then, if you knew, if I could take time to tell you about James's life, it would appall you at what he'd been through. I haven't seen him much.
But I know that day the Lord dropped eternal life into the boy's heart. And wherever he is, he began a good work in him, and he will perform it until the day of Jesus. So you never know what eternal value is taking place in a big day celebration just like this. All right, Father, I receive the offerings of the people. I receive their commitments to be here and to bring one visitor. I receive their tithes. Now, as a result, I'll speak a blessing over them once that tithe is received. And I'll speak that blessing as my office gives me an anointing to do so. And I thank you for that today in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, gentlemen. Yeah, he needs to. Father, first of all, I speak a blessing over. I receive these offerings, right? Lord, they're precious. They represent the heart and the desire of the people. Represents their hard work. You told them how to tithe. You taught them. You showed them. And just like Melchizedek met Abraham returning from the slaughter of the kings and had all the spoil, to whom he gave a tithe of everything, and Melchizedek turned and blessed him and called him what he is, the father of many nations, and that his seed would cover the earth like the sands of the seashore cover all of the sands. Oh my goodness, Lord, I speak that blessing over the people. Their blessing will be from their spirit to their soul, their body, their finances, their relationships, their lives, and their ideas, their inventions, their supernatural ability to know how to invent and move forward and be blessed. I speak these things to them in Jesus' name. Amen. This is yours. Talk. What happened to you? Well, you had to put in the hospital, go to the hospital for a month. And then every time they do the skin grafts on him, he'd have to be put under, and his kidneys would work less and less. And so finally, he had to go on dialysis 3 times a week.
This week, my first week not having to do dialysis. So. And I go back tomorrow, do blood work, and go back to the doctor on Tuesday. So hopefully they'll say I don't have to do it no more and take the ports out, and I can go back to work. Amen.
All right, you hear her speaking blessing? Just point at him. Stretch your hand out to him. Start speaking blessings at him. Tell his body what to do. Tell his kidneys to straighten out. Tell his mind to flow normally. Tell his blood to clean up. Strength return to him. Go back to work and get a raise, a big one. An easier job with much less stress, a whole lot more blessing, and no burden.
I receive.
Okay. All right. Give that man a hand. All right. I don't want to do it. I want them to hear it too. Kids on the Word have store day. So let's let Kids on the Word go. All right, those of you that would be more comfortable to sit up here on this third row, I've got an empty row. I want you to come up a little closer. Those of you that might be a little more comfortable on the third row, come up to the third row and sit here, be a little more comfortable. I want you to hear these guys up close. Those of you that would be more comfortable on the third row, come on up here. This third row right here is vacant, and I don't want to just this this void. It helps the minister and helps the service if some people move to the third row. Right here, this vacant one that's right here that has about 7 or 8 seats in it. Third row. There you go. Come on up. In Jesus' name. I'm pastoral commandment. Find somebody that'll get on that third row, Pastor John. That's what you need. Third row. Third row dweller. Praise the Lord. There was a time I'd say that, Nate. It's like musical chairs. They go to jumping in it. There you go. It's better for the ministers. It's better for the anointing. That people are not psychologically at a distance. You know, if you had a church with 500, you'd have to rope off the first 300 to get them in here to get it growing, grow from the front back. There we go. Give them a hand. Let me say no more. Kevin and Leslie McNulty are here. I want you to hear this testimony. I promise you, you have never heard anything like this in your life. Please welcome this fabulous team of evangelism to Church on the Word.
There you go. Thank you, Pastor.
You're welcome.
Come on up.
Oh, yeah.
Come on up. I'm out.
Wait. While you're standing up, because you've been sitting for a while, stand up. Let's just pray, shall we? Father, we thank you for this service today. Just say this with me. Say, here we are, Lord.
Here we are.
We're excited about, it's May 7th, right? Yep.
Excited about
now, May 7th. We're excited about expansion.
About expansion.
Use me, Lord.
Use me, Lord.
Thank you, Father.
Thank you, Father.
That you're in me.
You're in me.
You're on me.
You're on me.
You're around me.
You're on me.
And everywhere I go,
you're with me.
So we do worship you, Father.
We do worship you.
And we thank you,
for today.
In Jesus' name. Amen. See, I wanted to speak to you in Russian. Prezhajevatsya, pozhalosta. Anybody speak Russian here? Садитесь, пожалуйста. No? Nobody? Okay, drats. You don't speak Russian in Georgia? Parlez-vous français? No French? Oh. Somebody, yeah? Un petit peu?
Habla espagnol?
I speak French. French bread.
Qué bueno. Me gusta.
Un poquito, solamente. Well, it's a... ¿Cómo está? Muy bien, gracias. ¿Y tú? I guess I should say, yeah. And is that the right one? Never mind. Usted, that's right. You're usted. I couldn't remember usted because vos, you're itu. Vos? Hallelujah. Well, let's move on to the Word of God, shall we? Whoops. They always tell me I don't need a microphone when I preach. I don't know why. God made me that way, right, babe?
Amen.
Before we get started, before he shares a word real quick, we have some projects. People ask us, where do you live? Well, we have a base in Florida, we have a base in Russia, and we have a base in India. And the Lord gave us a privilege of working with Dr. T.L. Osborne for the last 16 years of his ministry. And we were his international outreach directors. We preached with him. We shared the events that we did together.
Other than his wife, we're the only ones who've ever done it.
Preached that long with him in any capacity. And it took two of us to even do a tenth of what his wife did in his ministry. So Daisy Osborne was an amazing woman of God. And but what we had the privilege of doing was participating in two projects. You know, we brought Dr. T.L. Osborne for the first time to the Soviet Union, actually the ex-Soviet Union in the mid-90s. And he had, his books had been translated there. They had been actually typed on, you know, old typewriters with carbon pages, and they'd been circulated in the underground church, but he'd never been to that part of the world. So through a series of very divinely orchestrated situations, if you will, or scenarios, the Lord brought our paths together. And we were able to take him across the ex-Soviet countries preaching, and he began sharing about tents while he was there. And the Lord had already put in our hearts the desire to get a tent, a gospel tent. And when we shared that idea with him, he said to us, well, that's not God. We're thinking, you've just told the entire population.
Belarus,
and I think he said it in St. Petersburg, a couple of places, St. Petersburg, Russia. And so he just looked at us and he said, how many territories, how many states or regions are there in the ex-Soviet countries? And we knew there was a little over 100. So we looked at him and we said, well, we guess the answer to that question is we need 100 tents. Which was good because, you know, a tent that should have cost us about $25,000 to $40,000, all of a sudden in term of 100, it didn't seem like it cost very much. So it can actually be a boost to your faith. When you have a target that is so unreachable, that the one that was so unreachable before now becomes very reachable.
$10 million project.
Wow. So anyway, to make a kind of a long story shorter, we now have of 80 tents. We've got two facilities that are producing the tents, and they're popping them out pretty quick. And sometimes we get an update, and it's like, five more tents went out. And it was like, oh, hallelujah. But that project we picked up, and Dr. Thiel, he said to us as the project started moving, he said, if I was a younger man, I'd do this project. He said, but I'm not. So you've got to do it. He says, and I'm going to help you. So he helped us, you know, connected us to a few people, some people in England to put some good seed money into the project and different places. And then
R.W. Schombach, he said, Kevin, I want you to come to Mexico City. And it wasn't for one of our meetings. And I said,
you mean T.L. said that?
Yeah. So I said, well, why are we going there? Why do you want me there? He goes, show up. I need you to shake hands with somebody. So I had to fly all the way to Mexico City just to shake hands. And R.W. Schombach was there with him. He said, I want you to shake R.W.'s hand. So I shook his hand. I said, okay, now you can go back. And I said, you know, he doesn't always, you know, leaders don't always tell you why they're doing things.
No, they just expect you to be there.
Yeah. And, say that again, please.
Leaders don't always tell you all the details. They just kind of expect you to be there, and you show up.
Shalabala.
So then, want to learn something from them.
So then I got a call from RW's offices in Texas, and about a tent is now yours. And I'm like, oh, that's interesting. And I knew I shook hands with him, you know. And what happened was that he was going to be visiting Osborne in Tulsa, and when he came to Tulsa, on Osborne's desk was a flyer from us. And he goes, who's that? He goes, this is the people I wanted to talk to you about. They need your tent. And so we ended up getting his tent.
Yeah. Well, he'd put a tent in Eastern Europe, I think, and that's the one he gave us. Yeah. So we got his tent out of Eastern Europe. So praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
So we're going to, in just a little bit, I want to hand you out this bookmark. It'll show you kind of, and it has our projects for 2017, and it also shows you where the tent meetings have been conducted. I think there's close to 800 locations now where there have been outreaches across Eurasia. He is faithful, I tell you. And then, but, so the second part of the project.
Can I borrow your glasses? All right. I don't have mine here with me. So. Great.
Shall I go on?
Yeah.
Go on? Yeah. Okay. So the second project that Dr. Thiel took on probably in the last phase of his ministry was he always had a special love for France. But since nobody speaks French, I'm assuming nobody's French in here. Is that right? But the French are a little bit... Well, how would we say it? Let's say it this way. At the same time that America was having a revolution, France was also having a revolution.
Right.
And Lafayette, that was on the shores of America, yes, who was a great hero in our battles, returned to France because they were enduring a revolution. The difference between our revolution and their revolution is that theirs was a total disregard for the church because of the excesses and the luxurious lifestyle of the ruling kings and what it transpired when they wrote their document for revolution. They wrote it on the basis of the nature of man and the removal of God. And so it has, so that, and that document is really the foundational document for all of the European Union. And because of that document, actually many countries have not completely signed into the EU, places like Poland.
Right.
Because Poland, they do not embrace that.
Yeah.
Because Poland is a Catholic nation.
But Brussels has signed off, no, there is no God, basically, for Europe. Wow. So
and for those of you who go to school who want to believe that our founders quoted, you know, on the nature of man and the writer of that as well, yes, we cited him, but we cited him for why we did not want that in our Constitution, for not for why we wanted it in, but why we would not put it in. And so they had a revolution and we had a revolution. Ours took us to God. Theirs took them away from God. And so the French, even the documents that were formed for the Russian church, our leaders flew in and took parts of that document back into Russia to form the new laws on religion and the constitution in Russia as well. And even though there are new laws in Russia and it's complicated the preaching of the gospel, if you're legal, you can still preach. And we've got a lot of preaching still going on in Russia right now. So hallelujah. But the second project that Dr. Thiel picked up a signal from the Lord about was, he said, Lord, I have the French on my heart. I want to help the French. I want to help the French. And he said, but they're so obstinate. You know, they're hard to help, Lord. The only revival that the French have ever had is through the Gypsy community. And that was in like the 60s. And they had a little ingathering from the French nationals through the Gypsies. But the Lord said, whispered to Dr. Thiel, don't give up on the French. You can go in through the back door. So we took off across French Africa, training the French Africans and empowering them with literature and a vision of miracles, evangelism, mass crusades. And we sent them to Europe to preach the gospel. And now there are, and we're not the only ones that I'm sure did it, and there are many, but there are hundreds, if not thousands, of French Africans preaching the gospel in Europe right now. So we understand from the Lord that these two things that God put in our hearts to do with Dr. T.L. Osborne, these two ministries, we have a man by the name of Bishop Sonny Emmanuel Mukwenzi. He was driven out of the Congo. The president tried to assassinate him about 15 years ago, and they assassinated his brother thinking it was him. Wow. Because he was such an influential pastor, but
He oversees right now, currently over 100 churches in the Congo, and he's just...
He can't go there. He does it via Skype.
He was the largest minister of the Pygmies as well, but he had to flee because... they wanted to kill him and his whole family.
So he has churches across Europe. He is an ordained bishop of French Africa by one of the largest church organizations in West Africa. And so he has moved into Florida. And then our leading evangelist has moved into Florida. And so we continue with all of these meetings and strategizing to break up the fallow ground in Europe.
Amen.
And we are taking the gospel, and we're planning meetings in Belgium, in Dresden, I'm going into Albania, we're going, and to the Ukraine, because Ukraine is very open right now as well. And in these meetings, our goal, you see, the immigrants are all over Europe, and the immigrant children, the children of the parents who move to Europe, they have no identity. They're no longer Congolese, but they're not French. They're no longer Russian, but they're not Belgis. They're no longer Ghanaian, but they're also not German. They may have a German passport, but they don't have a German identity. So we have a great ingathering potential of young people, probably from their 20s, we could say youth, but when this tent ministry began in Russia, the people, the strong evangelists that we have today, they're now hitting 40. And maybe they're up into their early 40s. But when they all began, they were in their 20s. And so we're looking to Europe for the immigrant children.
And that out of these immigrant children that have no identity in a previous identity and no identity in the land in which they live, and the Muslims too, in the name of Jesus, we call them in as the laborers, the workers, the disciples, and those who will shake up Europe with the gospel in the name of Jesus. Amen. And folks, it's coming to America. I would say, get ready, get in, hop in, hop in, or it'll pass you by.
We actually were planning, without all the fervency that's now in America, we were planning tents in America. And people say, in America? You said, yeah, I know, we've never done anything in America. Hardly ever spoke anywhere in America. Just didn't have it on our radar. But this year, we believe the Lord is saying, wake up, America.
Yes.
Yeah. Amen. So we're calling pastors, say, listen, we're coming to America, and then making arrangements for tents in America.
When we're here in Florida, I'll tell you this, when we're here in Florida, when we moved to Russia many years ago, and we would, if you want to be in the harvest, how do I say this right? I got to say this properly. How do you break up the fallow ground? There is a portion of seeding in the spirit. There's an importance of prayer. And there's an importance of understanding. Brother Hagin, I happen to have the privilege of going to Rhema when Brother Hagin was leading prayer school. To this day, I marvel that I didn't have to work and I went to prayer school every single day. And the year, when I left, he no longer did prayer school.
Wow.
And I learned from that man how to intercede for a nation. I remember when I was there, I think obviously Reagan was in power or was maybe his second term, and we were interceding for him, and I would cover my ears and lay on the floor because I wanted to see, am I praying? Am I flowing in the Spirit? Am I hearing? Am I learning? And I'd get visions. And then just immediately Brother Hagin would say something similar. So it was a training ground where I learned to hear and to obey and how to pray. So when we moved into Russia, we spent hours every morning in prayer. Everybody would come to our place. We didn't have offices at that time or facilities because you could barely rent a place in Russia. So our apartment would fill up every morning at 9 a.m. with all these missionaries and nationals, and we'd be interceding in the Spirit, and God would show us things. And then
26 missionaries.
Yeah, and then our interpreters would walk in sometimes in the morning a little later. I remember one in particular, name was Natasha. Natasha would walk in and she'd say, you guys are praying out the headlines. You're speaking out specifically what's just been released. And she'd stop and she'd say, you don't read Russian. How do you know these things? You see, folks, and that's what's happening. That's the heavens are open that way over America right now.
Yes.
Enter in, enter in, and experience it. And you will be a part not only by using your feet, but you'll be a part by using your mouth and your prayers, because God needs us to continue to pray in the name of Jesus.
Yes.
Amen. Now, prayer without moving feet can be very ineffective, but prayer with moving feet can be extremely powerful.
Yeah. Amen.
Amen. So we are gathering every week, and it's amazing how when we're there, when we gather in this prayer meeting, we'll get up the next morning, and I mean, we just got aggravated a couple of weeks ago at the fact that, excuse me, this is a little political, but that this new president hadn't fired some people.
Yeah.
It's like, God bless you, sir, but any administration ought to recognize you need to fire a few people if you want your team to flow with you.
Yes.
Forgive me if you don't agree with that, okay? It's all right if you don't have to agree, but I was raised in the business world and in the corporate world. If people aren't on your team, sometimes you just got to move them on so that you can get agreement.
Yep.
You need agreement to get things done. So we just got I got a little angry, and the Lord just, boom, out of my mouth. Give a man boldness to fire people. And everybody's looking, there goes Leslie again. You know? So And I mean, when you read the newspaper the next day, all these people are laid off. And I'm like, wow, Jesus. Now, you know, you're not the only one praying that way. He's got hundreds, if not thousands, praying that way across the country. What I'm telling you is, you can get in on it too. The heavens are open. God, because you have someone, he may not be perfect. For sure, I would say he, the man, is not perfect. I don't want to do politics. And even when he walked into that Congress hall, I'm shaking my head going, I do not believe that Trump is the president of this nation. I'm just going, I do not believe this. I'm like,
do y'all, I still do it when I see it.
Pardon?
The alternative
was worse. I know. Yeah. But it's not about that he's the... He may very much be the man of God, the man that God has chosen. My point is this. In his heart... There's something going on in some people somewhere in positions of authority because we have access in the spirit to pray.
Yes.
And in the early days in Russia, when Yeltsin was there riding on tanks and things were happening, we had such access in the spirit to pray. Wow. So take this moment, take this access, and if you don't like what you see, get busy in the spirit praying and believing God that it change in Jesus' name. Amen? Now, Kevin will say, Leslie, you weren't supposed to do that.
He's very political.
Yeah, well, I'm not typically political when we come to a church, but the point is, there's access in the spirit. If you don't like what he's doing, there's access in the spirit. And I haven't seen that kind of access in America since Reagan.
What you're saying is that when we pray, they hear. God hears and moves quickly. Yeah. Our prayers are very effectual now.
Our prayers are very effectual, and they're very responsive. Listen, he was trying to choose one of his cabinet members, and I had a mini vision of him sitting at his desk, and I can't imagine that this man... It was this type of personality, but he was going like this. He was rolling his head, and he was trying to figure it out. And I've forgotten who it was, but I wrote it in my journal. But that next day, he made a major announcement, and everybody was shocked how things had shifted. So it was a very difficult decision for him, whatever it was. So I'm just saying, we have... He may not... He's extremely imperfect. Anybody in here perfect? No, extremely imperfect. But take the authority that God gives you in the spirit and pray.
Amen.
Yes. Amen. Let's not, in Russian we'd say, zhalovatsa. Let's not just complain about it all over the place. Let's do something in the spirit about it. Yes. Amen.
Amen.
All right, can I give these to the, do you have ushers that stand at the door or should, would you pass these out as people leave? Would that be all right? Are you all right with that, Pastor?
Yeah, it's fine.
Thank you. All right, I'm going to sit down, sweetheart.
All right, praise the Lord.
I'll even turn the microphone off.
Praise the Lord. Yep. Well, I was very touched with your vision for the upcoming event you're going to have here and the challenge that it will be. And Christians need challenges. We really do need. We need to press in. Today I'm going to share with you, Pastor asked me to share some things that I don't normally share and have never written down until recently. And then I just felt, you know what, you better write this down. You're someday you might go on and this won't be written. So I wrote it down.
Someday, very long time.
Yeah, 60 years from now, I'll give myself 120 years.
What do you need to do?
Those two books, I think they're in my bag. Yeah. Also, I want to do this. Your picture for 500 people, I was just pondering that, and I was thinking, you know, it's not what we do, it's what we care about. If we care about people, they will come. And so doing things is nice. But caring is warming to your heart as well as to the people that you speak to. So in all things, I'm an evangelist. In all things, we don't want to become professional in terms of turning people into some sort of card. They are people. They are eternal. And most important, I care about their potential not being fulfilled, because they can live lives in America where they fill their life with fantastic programs from TV all the time, 24. You can be totally, and the TV is no longer in the house. The TV is in your phone, and it's on your iPad, and it can totally block out the voice of God. And so I'm not against any of these things. I think they're wonderful that we live in this. This is our generation. Say this, our generation.
Our generation.
Yeah. So we have to deal with our generation. I'm not against our generation, but we have to understand it. And that there's this competition for attention. And this attention now can be so distracted, so moved, so that you could leave. You could lose 10, 20 years of your life just like this and not even say, wow, what have I been doing this last 20 years? You know, and so we have to, as Christians, we understand that the clock is ticking, that eternity is ahead of us, and that we have potential, supernatural potential in what we're praying, potential in what we're wanting to have happen, potential in where we want to go with this life, in what our life means. It's all full of potential. And around us, one of the small potentials is just people that they should have. When I was born again, the first thing that came to me after I was born again was everybody should have this. Say, are you an evangelist? I think I'm just a person with common sense. Do I have something that's really good for me? Yes. And my first thought after having it was, everybody should have this. I was raised when I was told by my mother, don't bother God, he's busy with those poor people in Africa. My priest said, don't bother God, I'll take care of it. Just come to church every now and then. So I had two outs, and I never did bother God. And so he had to initiate everything in my life. But when he did initiate, and I did find him, I immediately said, everybody should have this. I wasn't saying I'm going to win everybody. I wasn't thinking at all like that. I was just thinking, what I got is so good. I'm so happy that I have it. And I just think everybody, I mean, I'm nice enough that everybody should have it. And so I just, but what I would recommend along this thinking, along this line, is that everybody here in this room, possibly everybody, I would assume, but never assume anything, but everybody here has a story. How many here have a story? Okay. In other words, you're here, somehow you ended up in this room, somehow you end up in this city, but somehow you ended up with a relationship with God. And that is your story. That's your witness. That's your memory. That is why you're not something else. And that's why you have a different life now. And you're happy about it. Otherwise, you wouldn't be in church. You know? Of course, you could be a visitor here today. So. Matter of fact, you probably are. How many here are first-time visitor today? Right? Okay. Yeah. Praise the Lord. And so your story counts. You say, well, it's just my story. No, your story is supernatural. You got to remember that everything about you is now supernatural. You were something. Now you're something else. You know, you were born again, not of corruptible, but of incorruptible seed. So there's nothing wrong with you in terms of there's nothing in you, is because God sees you. He created you. He birthed you like he birthed Jesus. You were born again of, Jesus was born of a seed placed in Mary. And you also were born of a seed that was placed in his word, and you were born of that seed. And that seed makes you a new person. Old things have passed away. All things have become new. Not just I've got a job, I've got a family, I've got all these things that everybody else has. No, you have a lot that nobody has. Yes. You know, for you to discover that, that's you. That's your journey. We're not here to have a church. I'm not here to have a religion. I'm here to have an adventure. Yeah. I've been on an adventure ever since I met God. And I'll tell you about that in a moment. But for the 500 people, if I were here in this city, and there were 9% that were in a church, that doesn't mean the other maybe 50% or whatever are not Christian, but they're not definitely reaching a potential. Amen. You know, they're say, well, I'm a Christian, but, you know, I was. It's like saying I was married, but I'm not married now. You know, I did have a job. Well, that means you don't have a job now. You know, I mean, you know, you can go into that thinking. And so here they are, they're dormant Christians. Yeah. And when they could be experiencing an adventure of life. You know, the saddest thing in life, the saddest thing. There's a lot of things that you could say are sad in life. You know, you could lose your dog, you could lose your car, you could lose your job, you could lose a lot of things in life. But you know what the saddest thing in life is? To lose your will. To lose your will. In other words, I used to want to be this, but you know what? Now I've just settled into I'm not going to be that. I used to want this style of life, but you know what? That's just not me anymore. I used to have this desire. Now I don't seem to have that desire anymore. A lost will is probably the saddest thing in the world, where we as humans, we resign. We live a life of resignation. And here you are in a place where words are king. Words are producing life. And you're there resigned to a life that you're just going to walk through without ever having, desiring. You're going to walk through with sadness, with fear, with loneliness, with regret. And you say, well, that's just the way it is. That's just the way that life comes out. And that is the saddest thing, because God gave you a new life, a life full of potential, an unlimited life. I'm just finishing a new book called Unlimited. And the book literally is unlimited. As writing it, I've had to narrow it down to the first of four books called Unlimited, because there was so much in it that is our nuggets, realities that can work in our life, but they have to be applied. Okay, and that's you as a Christian, as a believer, have an unlimited potential. God does not set the limit on you, on your future. Only you set the limit. There is this great power, and I'm not speaking on power, but I just found the book that I wrote, and it's called Power. It was 68 pages, and I'm like, wow, that's a good book. And I forgot I wrote it, you know? the greatest power that I said, I mean, at the opening of it, the greatest power was the power of choice. The power of choice. And God gives every human, gives you and I, because I'm speaking to you today, this power of choice. You get to choose how far you want to go. You get to choose how much you want to have. You get to choose how far you want to travel. You get to choose what type of education do you want. How many languages do you want to learn? What do you want to create? You get to choose. God has given you this power. Why do I know that? Because no one can choose eternity for you. Your mother can't, your father can't, your priest can't, your pastor can't. Nobody can choose it. Only you have that power. It is the greatest power. And I just want you to use that. But just think, there's 500 people around you that have that also. They would wish, they would like to have a power of choice. They don't know they have it, but you can give it to them. So what I'd like you to do, what I'd like you to do is, Father, we do thank you, Lord, for touching our brother and healing him right now in Jesus' name.
I agree with that prayer.
Yeah. What I'd like you to do right now is to, and the pastor is going to help you on this. Okay, he really is. I want you to take just one piece of paper. It could be as thin as that. We don't have to take it right now, but I want you to, anyway, give me that book. Yeah, I'll give you just any piece of paper in it would be work.
Yeah. Here,
I don't have any paper with me. Oh, here's, this is good right here.
No, here.
Well, here we go. No, honey, this will work. Okay, this is your paper. Okay. What it is, this goes into your pocket, okay? Just like that. And it says, my story. Why? Because your story, if spoken, if written with compassion, with care, is very supernatural. You came across a supernatural being. You made a supernatural decision. It created a supernatural transformation. It gave you supernatural ideas about what the future could be, and then gave you access in your thinking to how you can create miracles in your life. It's an amazing story, your story. Say my story.
My story.
It's an amazing story. Yeah. I don't, what I just said is just basically maybe an outline for your story, okay? But you just have it there, my story, with, if you want, you can put a picture of yourself. But that, you don't have to, okay? But just there and have that. What after they read your story, because it is your story. See, I found about Americans this. Americans are polite. They might not take, if I gave you my track, they might not take it because it's my track, my story. But your story, Americans will take. They are polite to each other. We are polite people, mm-hmm. You know. And we will take somebody's story, if you say, this is my story. And then in that story, it would lead people to how they can have their own story. And have the church address on it. Have somehow somebody's going to pick up a phone when that phone is called. I find about churches is that no one picks up the phone when I call them. So I want your, if it's not the church, at least somebody who you know will pick up the phone. Okay, will be on that. And I'm not, you know, that's not here. This is the exception, but. But anyway, there has to be made, and what it is they need a prayer. Do you? And that's how simple soul winning is. Do you need a prayer? You know how I wasn't in 60 plus nations when I started off. I started off saying I'm going to win this city, and then I went to the city of Warren and just went door to door, and won it, and the church there now is the largest church in Michigan.
Wow.
So, but how did you do that? Well, I just said, when they opened the door, I would just say, I'm not a Jehovah's Witness, I'm not a Mormon. That was my opening line. You know? You know? And then it was, is there anybody here who needs a prayer? That's how you say, well, how do people have needs? People have hurts. All over us or all around us. And we have answers. See, the thing about Christianity is it's not a religion.
Right.
It's not a religion. I know we have made it a religion in America, but it is not a religion. All religions pray, people. All religions. We travel to all the nations and all of them pray. But only Christians get answers. Okay. So we live with an expectation. Even now, as I speak, I'm expecting those with tumors, that those tumors will dissolve. I'm expecting those with arthritis, that those joints will come back together. As I'm speaking to you, life is flowing out of my mouth. This body is simply a carrier of words. This body is not going to last forever. But while it's on the earth the next 60 years, it's going to carry words. And those words are transmitters. Those are eternal words. Those are words that are full of life. Those are seeds for the future of human beings. You want to say, how powerful is that? Let me give you just one example. Would you like an example of how powerful that is? Leslie and I, we were stranded in China. No money. No contacts, stranded in the center of the ancient capital of Xi'an in China. And Leslie, we're walking through a park, and Leslie saw, and there was 7 RMB, that's about 3 cents, on the ground. And she says, look it, money. So we picked it up, and she starts dancing.
Seven,
yeah. So she starts dancing. We're in the money, we're in the money. And she's waving this RMB, you know, and so we're, you know,
wait a minute, Kevin. The park was swarming with people. It's China.
Yeah, it's China. So you got to remember, yeah, there's China is just an experience. It's not an entertaining experience. It's an experience. That's one of those countries when they. I won't go into it. We'll stay on the story. Leslie says, let's pray. God's given us a sign. I said, no, we're not going to pray. And she goes, what are you going to do? I said, we're going to preach. I said, we've got to preach. We've got, I don't know how many, 600 Bibles, and they're all big, I'm carrying them on my back, and I don't know, 5,000 tracts. And I said, we've got to preach. So we went down to the center of the Xi'an, the capital, and just started to pass out tracts, and one little Chinese boy, he said, you love God like, and he said it in Chinese accent, like my teacher loves God. And I'm like, really? You can speak English, that's good. And he goes, yeah. And he goes, I think my teacher should talk to you. And I thought, you know what? I've had to run several times from the Chinese police. So I said, this guy doesn't sound like he is setting me up with an encounter, you know. So I said, okay, have him call me. So I get a call from this American. I'm not talking about Bibles on the phone. I'm saying, well, let's talk about bread. You know, do you need bread? He goes, yes, I do need bread. I said, well, I have bread. Let's meet. So I didn't know who he was, why he's there, but he was a geology teacher. That's all I knew. And so we met. I said, let's meet on a bus, because if it's the police show up, I'm going to just stay on the bus and keep going, you know? So we met on a bus. We met, and I said, okay, these are Americans, and got off, and they introduced themselves. They were undercover Christ for the Nations preachers, ministers, who were working at a school teaching geology, two schools. And Leslie had a word of knowledge. She said, she goes, honey, we're supposed to go to Wangzhou. I said, we can't get out of Xi'an, let alone out of the country. And now you're saying we got to go to another country? She goes, I don't know why, but Lanzhou also we're supposed to go to.
Help Lanzhou.
So I'm like, okay. And this guy brought with him, another teacher from Lanzhou. So I said, well, okay, what kind of bread do you need? We said, well, we both have geology classes. We're both, the classes finish in 1 week, and we both teach 300 students in each class about geology and the Bible all year long. We've been doing this. And so I said, great, well, come on. I've got that exact number of Bibles that I have. So I brought them back to the room where we were staying and gave them those 600 Bibles. This is a little bit long story. Can you handle the story?
Yeah.
Okay. And Leslie, when she was dancing and singing in the park, you know, we're in the money, she had a vision of an American was going to drop a paper bag full of money into your lap.
Of an arm.
Oh, yeah, you didn't say American.
A brown paper bag, and I knew it was full of money.
Yeah, so a paper bag full of money. Yeah, you didn't know it was in America. And so so when we gave these Bibles to them, the guy just dropped a paper bag into my lap. I thought it was a tie, really, because it was mushy. So I thought it was a tie. And I opened it up, and it's a lot of money. A lot of money. And I'm looking at him, and I'm saying, why in this country with so many needs would you give so much money to an American? And he says, I made a deal at the beginning of this year. Now we're finishing. We're in the last week of the year. I made a deal that whoever God that you brings, that you bring the Bibles to me, whoever that is, I will give him my tithe for the year. Oh, wow. And so we can get out of town. Praise the Lord. But the story doesn't end there. The point is this, is that we got out of town, we took a bus to Beijing, first a train, then a bus to Beijing, the capital. And guess what year this was?
Tiananmen Square,
1989. We ended up, Leslie and I are the first ones in the mall, and with camera, with video, filming the student protest, 1989. This is where China killed its own students. And so we're there, and we said, well, the bus driver said, I can't take you any further. There's a million students out here. They're jamming the streets. I'm going to have to let you off here. So so we have all these tracks, so we're passing out tracks. For about 3 days, 4 days, I forgot how many days it was, we were passing out tracks to these students. And then it was like, you could feel wars in the air, wars in the air. So we left on the last train out of town. And then war broke out. They don't even announce how many people were killed in that. But a lot of people were killed or put in jail. And so I just said, well, thank God we're out of the city. Thank God, you know, we're on our way out. And 20 years later, Charisma Magazine calls up and says, there's a guy from China here who wants to talk with you. And so I told them, forget it. I'm not going back to China. Tell him I'm not going back, you know. And he really came all the way here just to talk with you. Well, tell him, really, I am not going back to China, you know, until I can drive a truck all the way across the border with big Jesus sign on it. I don't want to go back in, you know. And so I said, no, really, please. He really has to talk with you. So I said, okay, I'll go. I drove up to Charisma. And Leslie and I met this gentleman. Charisma is in
Orlando, Florida.
Yeah, basically Orlando, yeah. So this Chinese guy comes up and starts just crying and thanking me, thank you. And I'm like, do I know you? and he says, yes, you do know me, and I know you. I said, how do I know you? He goes, Tiananmen Square, 1989. He goes, you handed me a tract. And I am one of the student leaders that was head of the protest. And my professor, my family, and the students all blamed me as one of the ones who was ruining China with this march. And they threw me into jail, and they locked up the jail cell and threw me in there, and I'm in this lonely, dark jail, and all I had was this tract in my pocket. And in that jail, I met Jesus. And he goes, now I am taking 200, I'm the head of a large Christian organization in China, and I'm taking 200 pastors, leaders, evangelists across the Tianjin Mountains into Kyrgyzstan, Kazakhstan on the way to preach in Jerusalem. And you have tents in Kyrgyzstan, Kazakhstan. Could we preach in them? I said, yes, you can. But I'm just saying that you sometimes think, well, what does that matter? Words matter, people. Words matter. Your story matters. And it's your story. No one else can say your story or write your story. But go ahead and put your story on nothing more than that. And give it to somebody who has a phone, and that will answer, that will respond, and you will find that people will read your story,
own cell number on it.
Oh, yeah. That's right. Put your own cell number.
Put your Facebook on it.
That's right. Here, use technology. And I just wanted to say that because of this vision you have of 500 people. You have those 500 people, and they need to hear from you. They need to reach their potential. Amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah. Oh. Well, hallelujah. The seeing Jesus is the theme of this of right now. And how I began, and I should be giving, oh yes, I wanted to give you some scriptures before. You mind if I give you a few scriptures? here's a couple scriptures. Matthew 16:19. We have lived, my wife and I have lived an impossible lifestyle ever since we met each other. We went on a plane together over into the Philippines, and what I had after we paid all of our bills, sold our car, paid the bills, bought a plane ticket, we had $1 left. $1 for the trip. So I said, honey, I've done this before. I don't hold it back. If you don't want to do this, stay home. But I'll give you 50 cents if you go with me.
I'll split it with you.
And she said she's going. So we got on a plane, and the fun began, the miracle began. And it's another story. But
it continues
even to today. I mean, we've been in these meetings planning on these major events across 7 European nations. So just if you have anybody who loves Europe, I have a place for them to put their money. But we've never waited for the money to do the work. We've always just started to do it.
Yes,
yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah. And so in Matthew 16:19, that story about who do men say that I am? That's Matthew, 16. When Jesus was looking for somebody who would have a revelation, and that revelation is what would carry them into, you know what happened with that revelation? When Peter said that you are the Christ, Jesus says, silver and gold, man has not revealed this to you, but my Father in heaven has revealed this to you. And everything in Peter's life from that moment forward changed. And the revelation, just today, just one revelation coming out of this room today will completely transform your life. You give attention to the revelation. You say, what revelation? Whatever one burns in your heart, whatever one touches you. And one will, I guarantee that. And that healing power, even as I'm speaking, is actually working in you. Those joints are being fixed. And those that arthritis is leaving. And I just know because as Jesus was preaching, the power of God was present to heal. And that same Jesus is now in me. He doesn't have a body. He doesn't have a body. He needs bodies. So I said, you can have my body. So he can speak through me. And if he speaks, he also heals. He also delivers. He always lifts. And that's, in other words, how do you know you've been in a Jesus meeting? You feel lifted up.
Right.
That's right. He always lifts. I have a long history of just the word lift, and how many times Jesus lifted somebody up. It's amazing, amazing. Yeah. So. Nothing is impossible. Mm-mm. Let me just, I've got a year here. Let me just talk to you about Jesus and how I met him. I'm a tennis pro. And the city of Lansing, when Michigan State University called me up. And the coach said, I want you to come and receive an award.
top 25 players last 100 years. And I said, you got the wrong guy, you know. But that's where I grew up in professional world of tennis. And that's where I met Jesus. What happened is I was in the middle of a tennis match, and as I was hitting those backhands, I heard these words, read the Bible, read the Bible, read the Bible. And I'm looking around saying, who's talking to me? Couldn't see anybody, just went back to playing. And as I'm playing a stranger, it's a match. And as I'm playing, I hear again these words, read the Bible, read the Bible, read the Bible. I'm saying, there's an invisible person here. So I went up to my opponent, and I'm saying, you're going to think I'm crazy, but there's an invisible man talking to me. And he's saying, read the Bible. I said, isn't that crazy? And he says, no, that's not crazy. He said, come follow me. So he took me out to his car, opened up the trunk of his car, and inside were hundreds of books and Bibles. He put them into a box, said, go read. So I took those books and Bibles back to my apartment, and I began to read. And that began the journey. I read and I read and I read. For about 2 weeks, I was reading. And I had this sense. I said, God, you're trying to say something to me. Something is blocking me from hearing it. But I sense as I open up this book that I'm not connected to you. But I think you want me to be connected to you. I don't know if you've ever had that experience, but it's like there's something that we're just not jiving here. And so I went outside underneath an elm tree, and I just said, I've got to take a step. I've been reading about Jesus is definitely the theme of this book. So Jesus, I'm going to accept you into my life. Whatever that means, I receive you into my life, and I give you my life. At that moment, the world began to change immediately. Two things happened. A scrub brush hit me right on the inside, and it started to scrub. And I'm like, wow. I said, I didn't know I was dirty, but I'm feeling clean. And I feel like my past, everything in my past, everything I've said, thought, done, everything was being washed away. I felt like something was just washing me, totally washing me on the inside. And then just a moment after that, It was like a vision I had, a heaven opened up and a different voice, not the voice of Jesus, but this other voice said, I'll see you here. And then heaven closed up. And so two things happened to me within minutes. One was my past was forgiven and forgotten, and two, my future was secure. Now, when you're raised in a religion, those things are never known. Never known. Nobody in my family knew that. Nobody in my church that I went to knew that. Nobody knew that. Nobody in the tennis world knew that. So that's when I had that revelation. Wow, everybody should know this. Past gone, future secure. Great. Everybody would want that, you know. So who trained you to be an evangelist? I trained myself. I got some good news. Everybody likes to give away something good that they get for free, you know. You know, it didn't cost me anything to give it away. So I became an evangelist immediately. So what happened was I started to, you know, just read. And 4 days later, I'm at the desk. And all of a sudden, it's like a wind comes into the room and starts blowing. I had pictures in my room, and the pictures are being blown around. And I'm looking, and I said, oh, I must have left the window open. So I went over to close the window, and when I closed it was already closed. So I turned around and I said, where is the wind coming from? And Jesus walked through the door. I know that a lot of people don't have this experience, but you don't have to have this experience. But maybe I desperately had to have it. I don't know. You know? But he walked through the door, and he came up to me, and he said, what are you going to do with the rest of your life? Well, I'm looking at him. And I'm thinking, man, I've got a great job, you know, head coach already at a major university, 22,000 students, going to be primed for another job, 40,000 students. I said, and I've got all sorts of opportunities, more than I could handle. And he says, and out of me says, I'm going to gather and collect dead bodies and pump on old hearts. And I'm like, who said that?
And then, say it again. What did you say to him?
I'm going to gather and collect dead bodies and pump out old hearts. Isn't that strange? That's strange. That was strange to me. It's still strange to me. But that's what I said. I didn't know anything about dead bodies and old hearts. So I didn't know what that was either. So he says to me, go to your bathroom cabinet. And I had just bought pot. I hadn't opened it yet, but I just bought it. And it was in the bathroom cabinet. So I opened up the cabinet and I'm looking at this pot.
The first time, right?
And the first time I've ever bought it, there it is, staring at me. And Jesus said, what are you going to do? I said, well, if I'm talking to God, I don't need this. And I just dropped it right into the toilet and flushed it, you know. And he said, now I want you to go to your library. So he took me, I went through my library, and he started to, each as I pointed at each book, he says, keep, throw. So I just got out a trash can and started throwing the books that he said to throw. And I didn't, of course, you know, I didn't know what was right, what was wrong. But he knew. So I'm having this conversation with him. And I said, Jesus, I said, nobody in my family has ever told me about you. And I don't want to be a skeptic, but nobody in the tennis world has ever said anything to you. Definitely nobody in the church world has ever said anything about you. And I said, I'm not a doubter, but could you send somebody with some flesh and blood to talk to me? I said, I'm going to breakfast. I told them when I go to breakfast. I go to breakfast at 7 a.m. I start work at 8. I'll be at the breakfast hall, cafeteria, in the morning. Could you send one of your people to talk to me? Because I need to know. Nobody's even, this is like out of my league, you know. and then I went to bed. So I got up, went to breakfast. And as I'm eating breakfast, this guy comes on over and says, can I sit down here? And I said, it's a university. You can sit anywhere you want. And he says, well, I'm a minister. I was sitting over there at the corner of this cafeteria. And Jesus came up to me and said, get up, go over and talk to you. So I said, what does Jesus want me to talk to you about? I'm like, I don't know what. But the fact that you came over here, that says a lot to me, you know. So then I walked out and with an awareness that I was in a new relationship. Yeah. That this Jesus is alive. And that began the journey. That began the journey around the world. And it was a long journey. And
what year was that?
That was 1978. So, you know, I'm not afraid of doing new things. And just like with tennis, in order to learn how to play tennis, you had to learn how to lose. In other words, if you beat everybody in your neighborhood, you really need to go beyond your neighborhood. Mm-hmm. So now my interest was not tennis, my interest was not money, my interest was, who is this Jesus? And what does he want me to do? Because I have two things that I know now. One, my past is forgiven. And my future is secure. And nobody in my family, nobody in my neighborhood, nobody I've ever talked to ever knew those things. No tennis player ever knew those things. So I said, I've got the hottest item in the world, and I know it. I said, I don't know if anybody else knows it, but I know it. And so I began a journey. And let me just, for sake of time, because I know you'd love some of these stories that this, even though a short bit of knowledge, but it was enough to get me around the world. But as we're traveling around the world, let me share with you that Jesus is alive and he does appear to people at times. And I think if I were to sum up how I met Jesus, I would say I saw Jesus in a word. Okay, and that 2 weeks of reading that, he was there. I couldn't quite connect with him, But then I saw him in the Spirit. And that's when I could connect with the Word, when I saw him in the Spirit. And then there was other books that were 50-cent books that were in that box. And here's the deal I made with Jesus. I said, Jesus, I know you're here. I know you're alive. I know you got something for me to do. I said, here's what I have to do. I have to discover you. My number one focus from that work time on was, what is it that you do? I need to discover you. Not your church, not your religion. I need to discover you. And so I said, whatever I read in these books, if you do anything, I'm going to duplicate. That's the deal I make with you. And even the praying in tongues, you know, people, I like to pray for people to be filled with the Holy Spirit and speak in tongues. You know, I like that. But I didn't know anything about that. You know, and I was reading a book. One of the books was from a Chinese guy. I don't even know if he's a Christian, but he was from a Chinese guy. And he was praying. He was praying for God to give him the language of English. And I said, okay, Lord, based on this, you, according to this book, you gave him that language of English. So now I want you to give me the language of Chinese. That's all. And so I just sat down on my bed and said, give it to me. Because he didn't work for it. I don't want to work for mine either. So I just sat there, and nothing happened. And then, like, waiting a little while, nothing happened. Nothing happened. I said, Lord, what is it you want me to do? And he said, speak like a little child. So I got up, locked the doors, make sure nobody could get in. Opened up my mouth, just said, gugu kakaponene karishna opatene, and another language started to flow out. Now, not being in a educational situation, my only education was I can do it, but if I stop, maybe it will stop. So the first time I ever prayed in tongues, I prayed 8 hours. I walked the street all night long. I thought, if I stop, it's going to go away, you know. And so I didn't read that part of the book, I guess, you know. You know, but in the middle of that night, I had another revelation. Another voice spoke to me. And it was in a very deep voice. And it said, this is not of God. And it was really deep and foreboding. And I thought to her, I said, wow. I said, that's not God. You're right. That voice is not God. I said, but up until this moment, everything was with God. Said, this voice must be the voice of the devil. And then I had a revelation. The devil has a voice. And I thought, well, okay, there's a devil out there. I didn't know there was a devil out there, but he spoke to me. And so that was another. I had to learn these little things, you know, as I was traveling the world. And that there is a devil, there is somebody you have to encounter. And actually, I ended up within that next week. See, I found Jesus in the Word. I found him in the Spirit, you know, in that visitation. Then I found him in the actions of these people who are writing those books. Because as he was doing things for them, I was applying everything. I found out in one of those books that a person was healed by another person. And so I said, okay, Jesus, I said, you're going to heal somebody through me because I found it here. That's the deal. And the next day, you know, I'm going out to play tennis with a good player. He comes on crutches to the tennis court. And I said, he says, I can't play tennis today. You know, basically the doctor had put a cast on my foot and I've ruined my ankle and we won't be playing. I said, don't worry. I got good news. And he says, what's the good news? I said, listen, just sit down here on the bench, put your foot on my lap, and I cut open his cast. Yeah. I said, good news, you're going to get healed today. He goes, what? But I was the number one tennis player in the state. He had to listen to me. So I just cut it open, and I prayed over it. I said, now, stand up and jump. He says, if I stand and jump, it's going to hurt. I said, don't worry, I got some inside information. Okay, it's healed. And so,
simple challenge. And so
I said, just do it. And so he got up, he jumped. There was no pain. He jumped some more, no pain. I said, dance, do something more. So he started dancing. And I said, it's healed. He goes, it is healed. And I said, okay, here's a racket. Let's go play. So we played tennis. And so that began my instant, see, a lot of people go to the school for this stuff. That began my instant healing class, you know. I was the first one put into my own healing class. You know, and I don't know if you have big brothers here at universities. Ever been a big brother at a university? I was one. Where you just help little kids out who have, their families are in trouble and they need somebody to help them. So we big brothers, yeah. So I was part of that, and I was taking this kid, a big brother, doing thing by thing. I took him back to his house and, you know, gave it to his father, and just being that. And I was saying goodbye. I grabbed his hand to say goodbye to him, and I just grabbed to give a good man shake. He screamed, and I said, what's the matter? He says, my hand is what do you call it? It's not able to be used. Paralyzed. That's it. It's paralyzed. He says, my hand's paralyzed. And I just said, oh, you know, I didn't know that you're, he goes, I've only had one hand for 25 years. I said, I got good news for you. He goes, what news? I said, because he had these Catholic pictures on the walls, you know. I said, see these pictures? He said, yeah. I said, who's in that picture? He goes, Jesus. I said, that's right. Jesus is in the room right now. He goes, he is? You know? I said, he is. I said, and he's going to heal your hand. He goes, huh? And I said, watch. And I just grabbed his hand, prayed in Jesus' name, and I pulled it out. And his hand came out.
Wow.
And he said, hey, what's happening here? I said, you got healed. He said, I got healed. How'd I do that? And I said, go to your refrigerator or go somewhere where there's something heavy that you've never been able to lift. Go in there and pull it out. He goes, well, I've got a 5-gallon thing of water in there. I said, pull it out of the refrigerator. So he went to the refrigerator, pulled it out, and he was so happy because he now knew that his hand was healed. And he started dancing around the kitchen, and he was so happy. And I thought, boy, this healing stuff is good. You know? And so my healing ministry started, 4 days after my encounter, you know? And so all the things that we, you know.
That you read in the books.
Yeah.
Did.
Yeah. So I saw Jesus in the book. I saw Jesus in a spirit. I saw Jesus then in others. The others who wrote their books, I saw Jesus in that. And then, basically, I saw Jesus in me. That's why when I speak to you, I know that Jesus is here. I know he's touching what needs to be touched. He's lifting what needs to be lifted. He's healing what needs to be healed. He's straightening what needs to be straightened. He is fixing what needs to be fixed. Okay? So just say this, Lord, I thank you. You're here. You're touching. You're healing. You're lifting. What you are in others, you are in me. You walk in me. You live in me. You speak through me. We are connected. From this day forward, your life flows into my body. keeping it healthy and whole.
In
Jesus' name.
Jesus.
Amen. I did that in an American church, not a foreign church, in an American church a couple weeks ago in the city of Sorrento. And Leslie and I were just here preaching, and I didn't know what happened. Sometimes I don't know what happens in the meeting, you know. But this couple, the pastor couldn't take me out to lunch, but this couple took me out to lunch. As we were talking, this couple said, "We want to thank you." I said, "Thank us for what?" He says, "Our daughter was in that meeting, and she was in, she had a terminal, what was the disease that she had?"
Well, I know the one that had deaf ear.
That she came in from the hospital, the remember that couple?
Yes, dear, I remember a deaf ear.
Was it a deaf ear?
Yes, that's what I remember.
Okay.
You may know something else.
But she came in from the hospital, and that ear opened up in that meeting. Mm. And no one, we didn't have any testimony time, but it was amazing that the doctors said it couldn't be fixed. And we have to live with this. We live with an expectation.
Yeah.
We live with an expectation. Everything that happened to somebody else can happen to us. Praise the Lord.
Yeah.
I don't see a clock in here. Is that a clock over there?
12:30.
Is it 12:30?
Yeah.
Oh, my goodness. I didn't even need these notes. Okay, let me just close, okay, by saying.
Can you come back tonight at 6 o'clock?
Well, we will be back. I'm sure Leslie will have a word though.
6 until 8 o'clock tonight, right back here.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, 6 to 8 o'clock.
Hi, everybody.
Let me just say this. I wrote this new book, and there are a few words. There's a few words that people need to know, especially if you want to reach your potential. This is a big word. Okay, the word is now. Now. You notice when I'm speaking to you, as God is working with you now, not even what I'm going to be praying for you. But what we live in a present. If you're here today and you have not met this Jesus, now is your time to meet him. You know, if you need to be touched, now is the time to be touched. But you don't have to be touched. Millions of people we've preached to, and thousands that we've preached for and to, in terms of ministry of healing, they just sat where you're sitting. They heard what you're hearing, and God touched them right where they were. Oh, I have so many wonderful stories of that. Just amazing things that happened in that world. But now, and in this book, I'm going to. Do you have this book? Did I give this to you, John? It's called The 12th Chair. Okay, this is the best-selling book that's not known yet as the best-selling book. But I'm not kidding you, it is the best-selling. It is the best-selling book. The people who have read it, I've had one pastor in Florida call and said, "Kevin, I got to call you. I got to tell you." I said, "What do you got to tell me, Pastor?" He says, "I've stolen 50 of your sermons out of this book, the 12th chair. I just got to let you know." And I said, "Well, that's why I wrote it," you know. And then another pastor who I had a lunch with, he was up in Michigan, and he was, that was the worst lunch I've ever had in my life. The guy was just so ornery, angry, and something. I'm like, "Did I say something or do something or what's going on here?" You know. I said, when we got out of that meal, I just said, "That's the last time I'm ever going to talk to that guy." You know? And he was, I don't know what was wrong with him. He called up about 4 days later. And he says, "Kevin, I just called him to apologize. I was so mean, so angry. It wasn't you at all. But I was venting on you everything that was happening in that day. And I'd have to apologize. Plus, Kevin, that book that you gave me, that is the greatest book I've ever read." He says, "I totally agree with that revelation." And but in this book, I just wanted to say there's a thing called, and I'm going to give this book to you, Pastor, so you can preach the 50 sermons to these guys. Okay?
That's what you already got next year.
Yeah. But with this chapter called Then and Now, okay, it's a book that we live too much in the past. We have to live in the present.
Yes.
And our expectation has to be for the present. Whatever you learned in the past is to be duplicated in the present. I just give you a few of these words. In the past, it was the ministry of Jesus in a Jew. In the present, it's the ministry of Jesus in you. Okay. In the past, it was the ministry of Jesus. Pardon me. That's a different. Those other notes that were. In the past, it was the ministry of God working through two hands, two feet, and one voice. In the present, it is the ministry of God working through millions of hands, millions of feet, and millions of voices. If we would ignite God in our presence, those 500 people would be showing up in one day, because we would be the answer to every problem in the city. Our voice, our prayer. Because why? Because Christianity is the only religion, faith. I don't call it religion, call it relationship, where God answers prayer. And He requires prayer. He needs prayer to be answered. He wants you to be a successful prayer person. He wants the confirmation. There is a great word that you need to live with. Leslie and I live with it all the time, because we go out with these great challenges. Right now we're in challenge to reach all of Europe. And we go out there knowing it's impossible, but knowing that God will confirm us. I've gotten on planes knowing that I had to have a $10,000 bill paid for on the other side when I arrive. And on the way to the plane, I get a phone call. Hey, Kevin, just wanted to let you know, 2 weeks ago the Lord told me to give you $10,000. I forgot. Just now He reminded me. Just wanted to let you know. This is another thing, people, is that you think it doesn't matter. It's all does through the. Listen, God needs a voice that will hear Him. You want to get involved with what God's doing? He wants you to be involved. But it is a partnership between you and God. You want to do something? Well, God wants to do something too. You've got to partner with Him. And that sometimes is for ministry, sometimes it's for children, sometimes it's for your city, sometimes it's for a plan or a project in your neighborhood, whatever. He needs you. Say, God needs me.
God needs me.
Yeah. You're here not to be sitting in a church. You're here to be mobilizing yourself to reach your fullest potential. Because there's somebody who is hurting that's near you.
That's right.
And you have the answer. You say, well, I'm not prayed up enough. Dear Lord, I'm never prayed up enough. You know, I mean, it's not that. It is, I am ready and aware and able to be who Jesus made me to be. I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, but not I, but Christ in me. Okay? So this person that's in me named Christ, Jesus Christ, He is the one who needs my legs, He needs my feet, He needs my mouth to say Him. This is the name that's above every name. He needs that name to be spoken over everyone. To why? To lift them up. He's not putting us in a trial. He's trying to lift us up to where He is. And then we go on to heaven. Praise the Lord. But until then, let's be all that we can be.
Yeah.
Amen? And we don't have to be all that intelligent, all that knowledgeable, all that holy. We can't get any holier than God. So don't make that your final goal. If I'm holy enough, you'll never get that holy enough. but the fact is, He does live in you. And, you know, and well, hallelujah. That was almost the warm-up. That's hardly. Okay. I'll tell you what I'll do. There's another. Can I give you I'm going to come back tonight, okay? But here's another word I want to talk to you about. The word begin. The word begin. All the things that He began are the things that we continue. We don't continue religion. We continue the things that He began. Mm-hmm. Discover what He began. And then say, just like me, in simplicity, okay, Jesus, You began it, I continue it. Okay? And if he can't back up what He begins, then obviously why did He begin it?
Right.
Would you be interested in what He began?
Yeah.
All right, I'll tell you tonight. But Leslie's the preacher. All right, we love you. Anybody, have you seen any symptoms in your body change? Praise the Lord. One?
My mind.
Your mind. Amen. Our minds really do need to change. Thank God for good minds. Thank God for minds that remember, make a memory of a miracle. Make a miracle, make a memory of that, and duplicate it every day of your life. Amen.
Amen.
Also, I want to do this. Those of you who are young and you're too smart to, actually too dangerous, here's a life of a high adventures. This has stories of my wedding, has stories of when I was working with the cannibals. I was a little crazy. I actually did work with cannibals. And I'm here to tell about it. So, but there are... I'm not kidding you. That was the most thankful thing I ever had, was to get out of that place. Is there a guy here? It could be a girl. I don't want to be prejudiced, girl or guy, that you say, you know what? I've had this call to go around the world on my life, or I had this call to go to another nation, and you want some inspiration,
a desire.
You have a desire. Yeah, let's not call it a call. Let's call it a desire. Anybody here like that? Okay, I'm taking it off the plate.
One.
You got one? All right. If I throw it to you and it hits somebody near you, will you heal that person? Here you go. You'll enjoy it. Share it with others. Oh.
That's what TL did it.
Okay. Also, anybody here, you say, boy, is there a financial way to improve or to enhance my finances? And you say you'd like to have that. All right, this lady right here. Okay, River and Rain is the name.
Thank you so much.
For that. Throw it at her. Okay, when she's done with it, you read it. Okay. But a guy from Silicon Valley called me and he says, Kevin, I put that book on my top 10. And I said, you don't have to mock me. I said, that book's not on a top 10 for Silicon Valley. He goes, no, it is. I said, why do you think that? He said, because it's so easy to read, any simple person could read it. And I said, well, that's true. He goes, yeah, a lot of these money books are too difficult to figure out. That one you can figure out. Praise the Lord. Anyway, and this is for you, but I'm giving it to you after tonight. I didn't read his track yet. It's my story, so I don't know it.
Okay. Wow, somebody
say. Amen. Yeah. 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 Lord, hallelujah.
We would be absolutely remiss. We would sin beyond the worst sin we've ever sinned in our lives since before we knew Jesus if we don't get a bunch of money.
I want you to write a check out of Church on the Word for $1,000 to give to them, and I want us to all follow suit, whatever the Lord gives you, gives you a number, and give him some more money out of our account, and we're gonna bless Christian Adventures. Make it to Church on the Word, and we'll give them every dime of it, and we'll add to it. And then tonight at 6 o'clock, we're going to be right back. Let's capture. Hold on to this spirit. And the only way you can do it is don't engage in a bunch of natural conversation between now and 6 o'clock. Stay quiet. Stay sweet to each other. Stay peaceful. Stay in worship. Come back here at 6 o'clock, and from 6 until 8, we'll go right to the teaching. We may start with just some light piano music just to set the atmosphere in here. I want to give them the microphone quickly. I want at least 2 hours of these testimonies that I've asked them to bring to us. Are you glad Kevin and Leslie McNulty came to us today? They could have been anywhere in the world. They could have been anywhere in 60 nations, but the Lord directed them to right here. What does that tell you about Church on the Word? He loves us. Okay. All right, get your offerings ready, and we'll have these gentlemen to wait on you here in just a minute. I'll wait on you. Thank you for staying. Thank you for a 43-minute late departure is well worth this. Come on up, gentlemen. the hungry ones will be in and out time you get back. Okay, tonight you're going to share the four different times that Jesus has appeared to you guys in meetings. Tonight, four times Jesus has appeared to them in meetings. He's going to share those four times. Wow. Alan Russell, good to have you today. Chaplain works with Carol Foster. God bless you, sir. Thank you, sir. Praying for sick and hurt people. Just a man. I met him we talked 5 minutes before the service, and I'm already in love with him. My goodness. You need to get to know. Do you good to get to know him. Father, I receive the offerings of the people. We bless Kevin and Leslie McNulty. We bless them, sir. Whatever they need, whatever they want, exceeding abundantly above all they can ask or think. And we are part of that seed sown, and I've received a total 100% return, 100 times return to the people in Jesus' name. God bless you. Thank you. I don't know if we should do the notes. I don't know if I'll do the meeting, as late as it is. I know. Okay. We're still going to have... Listen, y'all. All of you, listen. I'm going to forego that meeting. All of you coordinators. Oh, my goodness. I just had a wave of the Holy Ghost. All of you coordinators that are working with me toward the big day event, the homecoming. I've got the sense that everything we've done for 23 years is for today. We will meet next Sunday afternoon immediately after the service. We'll have a dinner. Okay. Okay. The fundraiser dinner is immediately after service. We'll do a working lunch there too, and we'll go over all the details, all the things that you've been assigned to. Please have something that you can report to me, because all it is an inspection meeting. So I'm expecting some things out of all my coordinators, and my job is to inspect what I expect. And so this, again, is for souls. It's not to try to build Pastor John. It's, I have to tell you that. It's been a good day today. I agree with that prayer, don't you? Yes, I agree with that exhortation, don't you? All right. Has the offering been received? So, okay, let's all stand. God bless you. The Lord bless and keep you and make his face shine on you and give you the directions back to church tonight at 6 p.m. I love you. God bless you. You're dismissed.